Good morning, guys. Thank you for joining us this morning. Can't wait to worship with you guys and learn a little bit more today. So the scripture I have for y'all today is Psalm 37:4. Take delight in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. This verse can be taken out of context very fast. So let me explain this to you a little bit. Just because we believe in God doesn't mean that we're going to get a brand new car, a mansion, free Chick-fil-A for the rest of our lives, even though that would be great. When we give everything we have to God, we give our heartache, we give our trust, we give our doubts, we give the temptation of going back to what we gave up for Ash Wednesday, God will give you the desires that your heart should have and not the desires that you want. He'll give you the discipline to give you your heart, to give you English, to give him your heart, your doubt, everything that you don't really give to him. And when that happens, you're going to see a humongous change in your heart and the way that you live your day-to-day life. Because there's so much freedom that comes from giving him everything that you have. So as we go into announcements, just keep that in mind. Focus on that. So
I've seen shame, the kind that comes from mistakes, the kind that won't go away. When I turned around, they were right there to remind me. I've seen regret, the kind that messes with your head, the failures and the can't forgets. But standing here now, I'm thanking God it's behind me. I've seen nail-scarred hands reach out and wipe it all away, yeah. Now I see grace, hallelujah, I stand amazed. I'm staring at an empty...
Hey folks, we wanted everyone to know that we are updating our information in the office, and we would love to have everyone... If you've been here a while, if you just got here, even if you just filled the form out, we'd love to have you fill out the new information forms and get them to us so we can do a really good job of taking care of everybody and in the future communicating through email to everybody all at once. Also, there's a tab on your app on your phone called Information Needed. If you go there, you can fill out the forms online. So will you help us please to make sure we are doing a good job of keeping track of everybody and have everybody's information so we can take care of each other. Thank you. Hey Grace, it is the last Sunday for the alabaster offering. Remember the alabaster offering? We take our change and our dollars, and sometimes we put checks in these little boxes, and we receive it every 6 months, and we take these little boxes, and then we put the little boxes in the big boxes, and then we carry the big boxes into the church office. We count it, and we send those monies off to purchase properties, to build buildings, to support missionaries, and things like that. So, what I'm saying is, go ahead and bring your alabaster offering to the front right now. Thank you.
All right, let's go into a time of prayer. God, this morning I just ask for help. I just ask for guidance over your people. This 6 weeks is going to be hard, giving something up until Easter so that we can grow in you and strengthen ourselves with you. And it's hard, that it's hard to have that discipline. It's hard to not go back. So I just pray for help and guidance to clear our minds. Help us focus on you when times get hard. Help us focus our hearts on you and give you everything we have. And I just pray for safety this week, God. Amen.
Amen.
Hey, we got to stand with us this morning. Let's continue worshiping.
Thank you.
to God. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world. Praise Him this morning. Thank you, Jesus. We lift your name up, Lord.
flies tries to roll over my bones. When sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When broken death pains all I know. And I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. She no longer has a place to chance when I stand in your love. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Praise Him. Praise you, Jesus, this morning. Thank you, God.
So every once in a while, I am properly chastised. And in this case, it was a good reminder. Every now and then, I remind you good folks that our altars are always open. So don't wait around on some knucklehead to say, if you'd like to come and pray at the altar, you're always invited to come and pray at the altar. We pray together as a family, as a church family, every Sunday morning. And there are churches that have groups of folks who come before church and pray. There are folks who come at the close of services and pray. But don't ever, if you would like to come and pray, don't ever just wait around on Pastor Rich to give you some very special invitation with a bow on it. You do what you feel like the Lord leads you to do. And we're going to pray together this morning. And if you would like to, if you have a special need or something specific you'd like to pray about, we're going to pray together. And where you are geographically, I don't think to heaven means all that much, but you may be drawn to come and kneel this morning. So would you bow your heads? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that you know us and you love us anyway. Thank you, Jesus. thank you that you include us in your family. We were as orphans, and we've been grafted into your family, adopted into your family. We thank you, God, that you loved us enough to bring us into your family. God, we thank you. Thank you. Lord, you know our needs today, and we as a family of God, we as a church family, we've got so many things that are going on. So God, there are so many, just it seems like continual physical needs that we pray with each other and for each other. And then there are families that need your touch, folks who have financial needs, needs at work, needs at school. So God, we pray for each other this morning. Lord, we pray for Bill and Debbie Blackwell, who have been sick this week. God, touch Bill specifically. Lord, we pray for Dylan and Deanna Barnett as Dylan is still waiting on some breakthrough physically. God, we pray for Dylan. We pray for Teresa Carpenter and for her girls. Lord, we pray for Frank Miller, who had surgery last week, for Barbara Eakes, for Melanie and Dwayne Harris. God, be with Melanie and Dwayne. Touch, Lord, her physically. As she's been struggling with cancer, God, I pray for my friend Dwayne, and I pray for his wife, Melanie. God, would you touch? We know, God, that you are a healer, and we call out to you today. Lord, be with Pat and David Wright. Be with Sean. God, continue to touch Sean. Touch Shirley and Gary Gregory and Jim Meadows and his family and Pam Butler, who was in the hospital earlier this week, and many others, God, who are a part of our church family. Lord, we need your touch and your help. We need to know that you are with us. We just count on the fact that you hear us. We count on the fact that you're doing something, but you've told us, Lord, to bring our needs to you, and so we do obediently. Lord, we thank you for this place, this church, this address, this building. We praise you and thank you for the privilege it is to be a part of your church here at 3135 Trenton. But God, we today more so thank you that we are a part of a church that is millions and billions strong around this globe. And from heaven, you don't see geographical boundaries. You don't see denominational divisions. You just hear the praises of your people. And we ask, God, that you would be in our midst today and that we would make much of Jesus so we can go out and this week bring your kingdom. God, we will praise you for that in advance. In your great name we pray. Amen. Now, real quick, don't sit down, don't move it. A bunch of you guys aren't sitting at the same place you were sitting last week, and it's freaking me out. So I make one comment last week in Sunday morning that nobody changes places, and then half the people are sitting different places. So well done. Well played. Hey, look around, because now you're sitting next to people that you don't know. Introduce yourself to them. Tell them hello. Tonight, you can be seated. At the close of service this morning, we're going to come to the table and receive communion. If you are a part of our church, if you're a member of our church, you're welcome to come and receive communion. If you're not a member of our church, but you know Jesus, you are welcome to come and receive communion. If you don't know Jesus right now, but you would like to at the close of service, you are welcome to come and receive communion. We'll give you an opportunity to do that. If you are at home right now watching on the interweb, You've got a few minutes. Run to the kitchen, grab some sort of bread, some sort of juice. We will bless that, and we will receive communion at the close of service. I believe Pastor Joe said in the announcements video, we're trying to update our, the technical term would be database, so email addresses and phone numbers and all that kind of stuff. And I know some folks are very hesitant to share that information. That's cool. You be you. But if you would like every now and then to have communications from the church, whether that's something sent to you or emailed or texting you, you can get on the app and you can connect with us and update your information. We just would like to make sure that we're able to communicate and care for each other better. If you are visiting with us this morning, this is your first time, howdy. My name's Rich. I'm glad you're here, and we would love to invite you back. If you've got a home church that you're part of regularly, God bless you. If you don't have a place where you worship together regularly, we would love to invite you back. It is my belief, and it's just me, but it's my belief that every follower of Jesus should have a church where they're a part of the body of Christ. And so if you don't have one, we would like to offer that to you. We'd love to invite you back. We're going to receive an offering this morning. If I could have some ushers come and help me with that. It's almost camp season. So here in just a few weeks, we're going to start sending teenagers and children, little boys, little girls, teenage kids off to camp. And we like to help our students go. And we do that through the anniversary offering, people recognizing their wedding anniversaries and just donations throughout the year. We like to help our kids go that otherwise couldn't go. So let me thank you in advance for helping with camps. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your church. Thank you for the privilege it is to be a part of your family. God, bless our time together today and speak to us. You don't wait around to speak to us for somebody to say, Lord, please speak to us. You just speak to your children. Help us to listen. Would you be glorified, Lord, in everything that we say and do this morning, including this act of worship, bringing back to you your tithe and our offerings? Lord, take these gifts, bless them, multiply them, and build your kingdom here in Clarksville and around the world. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So I couldn't help myself. I've been in prayer time this morning when we prayed together. I've given little hints of where we're headed today, and I just keep saying one family, one body, and so I've been eagerly awaiting to preach this sermon over these last few weeks, and I'm excited about what God wants to say to us today. And even this week, a friend of mine who came, remember last fall we had some revival services, some renewal services. I believe it was in September we had a week of services together. And one of those pastors who came and shared was Matt Hastings. Matt Hastings is the pastor at the Hermitage Nazarene Church. And he and his wife have three children, and they've adopted two other children. And he said something this week that rang a bell because I knew where I was headed this morning. And he said this: the beauty of being adopted is that you have full rights as a family member. So some of you know what adoption entails. Some of you all maybe went through that personally. Maybe some of you all have adopted children. Maybe some of you all remember what it was like to be an orphan or be in foster care, be separated from family, and then that would ring different for you, being a part of a family and being brought in and given a seat at the table. And so as we were preparing for this morning, the thought came to me after I read what Matt wrote. The beauty of being adopted is that you have full rights as a family member. And adoption, that word is a part of the New Testament story. It made me think, can you imagine being an orphan with no father, with no family? And then finding a loving family, a loving father, a loving mother, a loving family, someone to welcome you. Can you imagine being an orphan on the outside and then having a family welcome you and bring you to the table only to look at the person on your right and on your left and say, I don't want to be a part of the family with you? I can't imagine that. Now, anytime we come to, you know, the Thanksgiving table or the Christmas table or a family reunion, there's some weird ones in my family. My guess is there's a few strange ones in your family too. But we're a part of the same family. And in the church, we're a part of the same family. And one of our general superintendents, his name is Eugenio Duarte. He said this, when I was adopted into God's family, I did not get to choose my brothers and sisters. I do get to choose what kind of brother I will be. So let me tell you this story. Let me illustrate this for you. I have a friend who pastors a church here on our district. And their church, like many other churches, they have local populations in where their church is that are different. So some of our churches have a Korean congregation, or some of our churches have a Spanish-speaking population, or some of our churches, one of our churches on our district has a Haitian service because there's so many people in the community. And as long as they are having a separate service, it's like we know where we belong. We're here, and those folks are over here. But here's what happened in this one particular church. They put up on their sign, you know, our church sign out here on the street. They put up on their sign some words that I cannot read because I don't read that in Spanish. So on the church sign, it said, I don't know, I'll just make something up. Hey, you're welcome to come to church here. Whatever that says in Spanish. Sure. Yeah, what you said. Hey, you're welcome to come to church here in Spanish. And so what they did was they had a congregation that was meeting in their church that was Spanish speaking. But here's where things got fuzzy. My friend's church had a service where everybody came together and they did everything in English and Spanish. Even the preaching. The pastor and the pastor of the Spanish-speaking congregation, they kind of tag-teamed the service. And I'm just going to shock you by saying not everybody was happy about that. And it made me think of my friend Matt's quote this week. Do you know when you're adopted, you get full rights as a family member? And there were people in the church that weren't happy about the inclusion in on folks that were drastically different on the surface than they were, and they was us, them language. And sometimes, I'm just going to try and shock you this morning, sometimes we allow our political views to influence the way we see God's kingdom. And that's not how it should be in the church. Ever. That's not how it should be in the church. I want to drive something home this morning as as strongly as I can. In the church of Jesus, not the church of Rich, not the church of the Nazarene, in God's church, the church that the Holy Spirit leads, there is no in and out. There is no us and them. There is no other. There is Christ, and we are adopted into His family. Now, don't agree with me too quickly, because I'm going to do my best to drive it home for all of us this morning, starting with me. I want you to open up your Bibles and turn to the book of Ephesians, Paul's letter to the Ephesians church. And we've been talking about the habits of discipleship so far this year. We're I don't know, 7 weeks in, 8 weeks in to this one theme, this one package of services. What do disciples do? And I started week one saying there's a difference between believers and disciples. You can believe stuff up between your ears, and it doesn't make any difference to the world out there. But disciples make disciples. Jesus told His disciples to go and make disciples. We today in the Church of the Nazarene, we today in God's church are called to make disciples. And so we've been talking about what does that look like? What are the habits of discipleship? And as we bring this series to a close over the next couple of weeks, I realize all the things that we're going to leave out. There's so many habits that we can incorporate into our lives to better be the disciples that Jesus calls us to be. But the one I want to harp on this morning, the one I want us to focus on, is the discipleship habit of unity, being a people that bring believers together. Because the world is watching. There is no us and them. There is no in and out. There's Christ. We are in Christ, and we reject any other. Is to reject Christ. And I'm going to show you that this morning in the scripture. So Ephesians chapter 4 says this. Paul has been talking now for a couple of chapters. So he's written before, but I can't go back and preach chapters 1, 2, and 3 this morning. So let's pick it up at 4. And he says this. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you've received. Go back to that quote that Matt said. Matt said, the beauty of being adopted is that you have the full rights as a family member. Can you imagine being an orphan, brought into a family, sat down at a table, and you immediately look around and say, I don't want to eat with them. I don't want to be a part of that family. That's unfathomable. And Paul writes to this church. These were real people in a real church, in a real location that Paul is writing to. What might they have been facing? Listen to this. As a prisoner of the Lord, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you've received. Be completely, five things here. Humble. Gentle. Be patient. Bearing with one another. In love, John Stott called these attitudes expressed at the beginning of Ephesians chapter 4, the five foundation stones of Christian unity: humility, gentleness, patience, forbearance, and love. Do you realize that in the early church, in the church that Paul was writing to, there were divisions, just like today. We'll talk about some of today's divisions here in just a second. There were divisions in this church, in the Ephesian church. The Ephesian church was probably like every other church. There were the ins and the outs. There were the us and there was the them. So in their church, it would be those who were Jews, those who had been Jewish, those whose heritage was Jewish, those who could go back to the sons of Jacob in their family tree. There were those who counted themselves as children of Abraham, as people of the book. And then there were Gentiles, people who were outsiders. They were Greeks. The Jews and the Gentiles. In this church, there were educated and non-educated. There were people who were free. There were people who were slaves. Paul drives home again and again a single word. Verse 2, be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit, the only way we can do this in the church today, the only way they could have done this in the day that Paul was writing this letter to the Ephesian church, the only way they could do this was through the power of the Holy Spirit. Good news is we have that same Holy Spirit today. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is, get this, one body. Not the English-speaking body and the Spanish-speaking body. Not those who are here legally and those who are here illegally. Not those who are like us versus those who aren't like us. There is one body and one Spirit. Just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all, and here's a great big word, in all. Big words today. One and in. How can we live like that? How, in a world that sees and fosters division, how can we as a church be one? So as we always should, let's go back to Jesus. Jesus' words in John chapter 17. Turn back to John chapter 17, John's gospel. And this chapter, Jesus is praying right before he goes to the cross, and he's praying at the Last Supper. He's praying for himself, and then he prays for his disciples, and then he prays for you. Did you know that right before Jesus goes to the cross, he's praying for you? John chapter 17, starting in verse 20. A part of a bigger thought here. Go back and read this week all of chapter 17. But Jesus says this, my prayer is not for them, the 12, his disciples. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me. That's you. Did you know that? By the way, put a big star in your Bible. It's okay to write in your Bible. I asked the author. It's cool. Write me and circle that. I don't just pray for them, my disciples, but I pray for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be, here's that word again, one. Now, I'm going to do my best to offend all of you here in just a second. So hang in there. If you like me right now, decide you're going to like me in 15 minutes, but because I'm going to try and shake all of us up. That all of you may be one. Father, just as you are, big word, in me, and I am in you, may they also be in us. Do you see that relationship that God has? Jesus is in his Father. His Father is in the Son. And Jesus is praying for us that we might be in them, because they are, even right now, 2023, USA, America, they are in us today. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you've loved me. In God the Father, in Jesus, Jesus in the Father, God the Father, Jesus the Son, in us. Very similar theme in John chapter 14. You can go back and read John chapter 14 as well. Christian unity means this person, X, is very different than this person, Y. But we are a part of the same family. Christian unity means that we can disagree, hear me, we can disagree on many things and still be part of the same family. Did you know that? Did you know that we can disagree on some things? So I'm going to start out a little silly and then I'll get a little more serious. Did you know that we can disagree on things and still call each other brother and sister in Christ? That in the church, not everybody sees things exactly like you see them? Did you know that? Did you know that there are people who sing Rocky Top and people that say Roll Tide that are a part of the same church? Did you know that? Did you know that there are iPhone people and Android people? Did you know that there are TikTok people and there are like 7 people that are still hanging on to their MySpace page? Did you know that there are people who like REO Speedwagon and people who don't enjoy good music? Did you know that there are people who are very, very pro-military and people who would say that they are pacifists? Did you know that we're even here in a town like this? Did you know that we can be a part of the same family? Hear me. It's not that we don't have disagreements. It's how we have disagreements. Did you know that there are Catholic people and Protestant people who are part of the same family? Did you know that there are white people and black people who are part of the same family? Did you know that? Did you know that there are conservatives and liberals, Republicans and Democrats, people who go home every night and watch 6 hours of the news, and people who do their dead level best never, ever, ever, ever to watch it ever again? Did you know that there are Trump people and Clinton people, Trump people and Biden people, that there are vaccine people and no vaccine people, there are mask people and no mask people that are a part of the same family? Did you know that going back to the year 2020, churches have split over those things? I want to say, no, sir, not here. But who knows what's around the corner? And if we aren't a people who actively pursue unity, that could happen here. Did you know that there are people who believe that God created the world in 6 24-hour days and people who have questions? And did you know that that's okay? Did you know that there are people who believe that Job from the Old Testament was a real dude and people that think it's a parable or an allegory? Did you know that? Did you know that people in the body, there are people who speak English and people who speak Korean and people who speak Spanish and people who speak Portuguese and people who speak Chinese? Did you know that from heaven, God does not care two bits about that? Did you know that there are people who fight for the Second Amendment and those who fight against the Second Amendment? Did you know that there are people who love the old hymns and other people who wouldn't know what a hymn book is? Did you know that there are people who love to dress up on Sunday mornings for church and people who don't see a very big deal about that? Do you know that there are people who think that if the King James Version was good enough for Moses and Solomon and Daniel and Peter and Barnabas, then it's good enough for us today? And then there are people that don't get that joke? Do you know that there are people who have been a part of this church for 30 and 40 years and people that are brand new this morning? Did you know that there are people who are third and fourth generation Nazarenes and people who don't know the difference between John Wesley and John Calvin? Did you know that there are people who are pro-choice and people who are pro-life that are a part of the same family? Do we have disagreements? Of course we do. But it's how we have disagreements. Did they have disagreements in the church in Ephesus? Yes, they did. But did that stop Paul from ringing that bell and continuing to remind them that they are one? They are one. One church, one faith, one spirit, one body, one. Not the English speakers over here and the Spanish speakers over here. One body. And if we can live our lives today in a way that resembles the kingdom that is coming, we're making progress. Amen. Christian unity is something that disciples work for. That's the habit we're talking about today. Disciples seek Jesus. Disciples do it together. Disciples pray. Disciples read the word. Disciples work for unity. It's not automatic. Folks, like in a current, like out in a river, the current is going downstream. If you get out and you pick up your feet, you're just going to be carried with the current. And the current does not lead toward health. The current leads toward division. And we, as disciples, have to fight the current and work for unity. And I ask you, to the best of my ability, I want to work toward unity. Will you join me? Christian unity is something that disciples work for. It's proactive. People who are constantly fixate and reinforce divisions in the church are not working for unity. People who constantly use the terms us and them, we and they, are not working for unity. People who stir up drama aren't working for unity in the church. People who gossip and talk about others behind their backs are not working for unity in the church. People who complain because they don't get their way are not working for unity in the church. But people who put unity before their own preferences are working for unity in the church. People who have strong convictions but value being rightly related over being right. Amen. I love that phrase, so I'm going to say it again. People who have strong convictions, but they value being rightly related over being right, are working for unity in the church. People who realize that Jesus never once asked his disciples to agree on everything. Jesus told his disciples to love each other. They're working for unity in the church. All this is done with the power of the Holy Spirit. Did it always work out? No. Read your Bible. Most of all of Paul's letters to the churches were corrective. He even calls out, I think that they're ladies. Let's pick on them. Euodia and Syntyche. Ever hear those two names? Know your Bible. Paul calls out two women in one of these churches, and he says, plead with them to get along. I don't even know what they were fighting over. It could be something serious, some deep, foundational thing, or it could just be that they didn't like each other. Paul calls them out, and we read about them 2,000 years later. One of these days, you know, we just might run into them in heaven and go, hey, what was that all about? Paul didn't say, you know, tell me, maybe I can take a side. No, 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 we're talking about unity this morning. All this can be done with the Holy Spirit's power that makes me love you more than I want to be right about the things that I have very strong convictions and opinions over. Disagreement does not have to create disconnection. Good people can disagree on important things and still respect and care for each other. It's not the disagreement that is the most important. It's how we disagree. Now, some of you are listening to me right now and say, well, Rich, don't we care about the cross? And yes, sir, we do. And there are some things that you will not be able to convince me. You know, there are probably things that I believe about God, things that I believe about Jesus, things that I believe about the Bible that you might not necessarily agree with. That's okay. I would ask you to treat me as a brother in Christ, and I'll try and treat you as a brother in Christ, even through our disagreements. There are some things that are foundational that as followers of Jesus that we should all believe. But I'm going to try and talk to you about those things as a brother or sister in Christ. And what we cannot do in the church is put up walls between us and others. I see things differently than you, some of you. Some of you might see things differently than me. It's okay. How are we going to love each other? The early church had divisions, and Paul tried to address those. We have divisions today. We need to address those. The idea that God loves everybody infuriates some people. Do you know that? When we say that God loves everybody, that sometimes that just ticks people off. They have to say that God hates the same people that they hate because their God is staring back at them in the mirror every morning when they walk into the bathroom. Disciples value being rightly related over being right. And who is the other that the Holy Spirit's been talking to you about? In just a moment, we're going to invite you to the table. Going back to that very first quote from Matt, being adopted into a family means you have full rights as a family member. Can you imagine being an orphan, finding a perfect heavenly father, and he invites us to his table? And we look at the person on our right or on our left and say, I don't want to eat with them. That is as blasphemous as a thing that I can imagine. God invites us to, let me say it again, his table. When I was adopted into God's family, I didn't get to choose who my brothers and sisters were. I do get to choose what kind of brother I will be. What kind of brother or sister will you be? Would you stand with me? So I want to pray for us as we close this morning, and then I want to invite you to the table. And let me just go ahead and give you a spoiler. There are going to be people who come to the table this morning that are a little bit different than you. They might believe differently than you. They might read their Bible differently than you. They might see the beginning, Genesis, differently than you. They might read the end, Revelation, differently than you. They might think differently about the world we live in. They might vote differently than you. They might speak a different language than you. They might view the church differently than you. We, followers of Jesus, need to be reminded that there is one body, one Savior, one table. And to divide ourselves isn't to reject the other, it's to reject Christ in them. And I don't want to do that. Who is the other that the Holy Spirit's been talking to you about this morning? Who's the them? Can you come to the table with them today? Let me remind you, each of you today, it is not your table. And it's not my table. It's not a very Nazarene table. It's not an American table. It's not an English-speaking table. It is the table of Jesus, and he's invited you. Do you come as one seeking and fostering unity? Or do you come strengthening those divisions that Satan would love nothing more than to divide us, because the world out there is watching? Would you bow your heads with me? Father, you want us to be one. One church, one body, filled with one Spirit, showing and broadcasting and sharing one love of one Savior, Jesus. I can't imagine that any of us here this morning believe that everybody believes just like us. There are divisions, there are differences. There are folks that are very, very much like us, and then there are folks that are very, very not much like us. But how are we going to live with those differences? Similar differences were in the early church, and Paul pleaded with them to be patient with each other, to forgive each other, to be humble, and to love, because we truly are one body. Help us as your followers to seek unity, to work for unity, to identify those places of division in our little realm of influence, to ask for your forgiveness where we have been dividers rather than uniters. Invite us this morning to your table, and we'll be thankful. In just a second, I'm going to ask you to come out of your rows if you would like to come to the table this morning. I've asked several folks to come and help me serve it, if you would come and help me this morning. And in just a second, I'll ask you, you can step out of your sections to your right and come, and you can take one of these little prepackaged communion packages, or you can take a piece of bread and dip it into the cup. And as you come this morning, you can go ahead and receive. And as you come this morning, if you would like to continue your talk with Jesus at the altar, you're invited to linger. But let me bless these elements. We're reminded that on the night that our Lord was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had blessed it, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This bread is my body, broken for you. As often as you eat it, remember me." And after supper, he took the cup, and when he had blessed it, he passed it to his disciples, saying, "This cup, this wine, is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you for the forgiveness of your sins. As often as you drink it, receive Christ. Receive me. Be saved this morning." You're welcome to come to Jesus' table. Come as one body this morning. Would you come? God bless you.
Start on the outside, the outside looking in. This is where grace begins. We were hungry, we were thirsty, with nothing left to give. Oh, the shape that we were in. Just when all hope seemed lost, love opened the door for us. He said, "Come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free and come to the table. Come meet this motley crew, misfits, these liars and these thieves. There's no one unwelcome here. That sin and shame that you brought with you, you can leave it at the door. Let mercy draw you. Sinners who have been redeemed. sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Come to the table.
Blesses his church, and you are a part of his church, and you can either bring us closer together, or you can foster and refocus us on the things that divide us, that weakens the testimony of Jesus out in the world. Be proactive. Build unity. Guard it. Be a peacemaker. Let me bless you as you go this morning. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you his peace. God bless you. Go and love on somebody in the name of Jesus this week.